Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the great state of South Carolina. I hope you guys are doing all right. I wanted to try to make several videos. I always say that. I want to try to just stick to one topic at a time. Let's see. I want to talk about the anointing oil. Several people are asking me about, you know, how to use it. Number one, I'd like to say I've already gotten about 3 praise reports back. And, you know, lots of times people don't tell me. So I know I've got at least 3 people have contacted me with a praise report about the anointing oil of healing, of, you know, being filled with the Holy Spirit when they use the oil, spirit of joy. So praise God for that, brothers and sisters. Like I said, in that same text of James chapter 5, it says that, you know, the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So, you know, I prayed fervently over the oil, and I asked Brother Sid to pray fervently over the oil, and we physically laid hands on the oil and prayed over it again together. And then I've had the oil right here asking you guys to pray with me. Now, I've got other bottles of oil. That first bottle I've used, and so I've got more. So I'm going to pray with that later on as I'm going to fill more bottles next time. I'll keep having a bottle of oil with me here. We keep praying over it. But anyway, brothers and sisters, there's lots of precedence for using oil. Now, there are religious people who will say stuff like, oh, and I mentioned this before. They'll say, oh, you know this. There is. It says in James chapter 5, I believe it's, I always keep forgetting the verse. I think it's verse 15, 16, long in there. James chapter 5, it won't hurt you to read more than a few verses. Just read the whole chapter. It says that, is there any sick among you? Let them call for the elders of the church, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall heal the sick. I've talked about this in a video the other day when I talked about the anointing oil. Anyway, so it's, of course, it's the prayer of faith, brothers and sisters. But James, the half-brother of Jesus, tells us, you know, to anoint them with oil. So the elders, myself, Brother Sid is the elder in the church of the firstborn. And many of you guys are elders in the church. It doesn't necessarily mean you're, you know, been recognized as an elder in a church, but you have been a Christian for a long time. You're a senior, you know, long-term Christian, mature in the faith. And by that definition, you're an elder in the church. Not necessarily that, oh, you're recognized, you got a title in a local assembly of believers. And as a matter of fact, we have a prayer team. I just want to mention this while I'm on the topic of elders. If you guys want to be on the prayer team, I think we have about 19 or 20 people now on the prayer warrior team. And a sister I talked to today, you know, brothers and sisters, I talked to lots of you guys on the phone to minister to you, to talk to you about different topics, about the Bible, of prayer, and this, that, and the other. Anyway, there was a sister who I just was talking to today, a mature sister in the Lord, an elder in the body of Christ. She's going to be on our prayer team, and she was asking me, you know, about praying for me. And of course, there's, you know, I know of at least a couple hundred people who are praying for me, and I want you to continue to do that. The prayer team is not just praying for Joshua's ministry. When people have a prayer request they send to me or to any of you guys who are on the prayer team or anybody through the YouTube comments or through the churchfirstborn.com, the website link is below this video. You can go there to the Church of the Firstborn is the name of the church, churchfirstborn.com. You can go on there that you can submit a prayer request. And then we send it out to all those who are prayer warriors. If you would like to be a prayer warrior, I think I put Brother Sid's email. It's, I believe it's sydney@churchfirstborn.com under this video and under all my videos. But you can, if you go to the website of the online church, brothers and sisters, you can just send a, put it in the prayer request, go to that like an email. That goes directly to Brother Sid. And Brother Sid oversees the prayer team, you know, along with me. But he's actually the one who's, you know, getting them and sending them out. If he has any problems or issues, he contacts me, brothers and sisters. So the thing about being in the ministry, lots of people, the problem with lots of people, I'm going to start preaching again a little bit. They looked at the preacher as like doing all the work. Okay, number one, a church is not supposed to be a one-man show of the preacher. Okay, now we're online here. This is an on-demand video. So, of course, I'm the one speaking on here. But a real church, really a home church, is really more like what the real church was like in the first, in the book of Acts, in the first century. People met in homes, it tells us in the book of Acts. They broke daily, you know, broke bread daily. In Jerusalem, they were meeting in the temple courts. But of course, all the Gentiles couldn't go into the temple courts. So the Gentiles, they met in houses all over the empire, the Roman Empire. And so, brothers and sisters, you talk about the gifts of the Spirit. It says, you know, let no more than a couple prophesy, and you know, and then the elders are supposed to decide whether it's from God or not. It, you know, it talks about only letting one or two speak in tongues and then someone would interpret and all that. You read about the gifts of the Spirit, you read the book of Acts, you read all this thing, you would see that it's not a one-man show. Like most churches are a one-man show. The pastor's doing all the speaking. And then a lot of people, they expect the pastor to do all the praying and all that stuff. But that's what church members are for, praying. Church, mature elders in the church are for mentoring people and helping people and doing the work of the leadership of the church, not just a pastor. Pastors are elders who teach. The Bible says the elder who teaches is worth double honor. It's talking about you're supposed to give them a double portion of financial support and all those things. But they, what it tells us in that text is it's one of them. The elders is anyone who is a, you know, a mature Christian in the faith who's in the leadership of the church. And then it just so happens to be that the pastor is an elder who teaches, an elder who is a pastor, but he's also an elder. So there are other elders who don't preach, but they're elders in the church. Do you see what I'm saying? That's what we see in the way the church developed in the book of Acts and in the letters of the apostles that we read in the epistles or letters to the churches in the books of the New Testament. We see that the churches were small home churches with not a one-man show, which we see in most churches today. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that being said, and that little ditty of information of truly the way the Bible wants, you know, the Lord really set up the original church. That's why I'm putting out this call, like Brother Sid. You know, Brother Sid is doing that as part of his growth and development and leadership in the ministry. You know, and I'm just, you know, if he has any situation or something and he'll come to me, which by the grace of God, he really doesn't. Brother Sid's a very mature, of course, you know, he's literally an elder, physically an older man in his 60s. And then also, he's been a Christian a long time. Even though he's been a backslider for many years, he's also been a Christian way back, you know, in his young years and went through stages of backslidden and walking with the Lord, backslidden and walking with the Lord. So anyway, everybody's at different levels, brothers and sisters. That's what the church is supposed to be about, discipling people. Many people are babes, but there are lots of you guys who are not babes, but yet you want to hide behind, you know, out there in the middle of the sheep flock and not doing, you know, what God has given you. For the Bible says, to whom much is given, much is required. You know, so God has given you much wisdom and maturity. You've been a Christian for 10, 20, 30 years or whatever. And as a matter of fact, one of the best, you know, elders in the group has only been a Christian about 3 or 4 years, a brother in Texas. In the Dallas area, is very mature in the Lord, but he's only been walking with the Lord like 3 or 4 years. You know, so it doesn't matter. You know, there are people that have been Christians for 30 years are still a little baby still looking for the milk, who have been pastors for 40 years in these denominations. Obviously, how can you lead someone to the infilling of the Holy Spirit with you yourself have not been filled with the Holy Spirit? You know, it's the blind leading the blind, as Jesus said, and they both fall into a pit. Because you've got the blind leading the blind. So if you don't have an experience, you can't teach something you don't know. Praise God. So, you know, many of you, though, you know some stuff, and you're not teaching people who are behind you in their walk with the Lord or, you know, not as experienced as you in their walk with the Lord. So that's really what the Church of the Firstborn is about. I think I mentioned this a little bit in videos, and I should, so I am remiss for not making all the videos I should make. You know, with the time that I have, I'm trying to do the best that I can. There's lots of administrative stuff I need to explain. You know, how to use the anointing oil, about the prayer team and all that. So the anointing oil, as I started, you anoint people with that. You can anoint yourself. You can anoint others with that oil. People that don't want to be prayed for, you can anoint. Like, say you have children that are not saved, you know, like they're already adults or whatever. Or your spouse, you know, you could anoint the bedpost around their bed. You could anoint the doorpost into your bedroom, into the doorpost of your house, you know, whatever. You could anoint, you know, their shoes or something, you know, and pray. It's a point of contact. And all the prayers of myself and all those people that prayed over that oil, you know, it's represented in that oil. God is honoring those prayers are in that. It's a point of contact. Not only do we have in James talking about oil, we see, as I mentioned this again, just to repeat it for those who didn't see it, the Apostle Paul, he was working as a tent maker and couldn't go pray with people. They brought handkerchiefs. He prayed over them. He went and they touched people and they were healed. Peter walked down the street and his shadow, when it fell on people, they were healed. God can do anything, anytime, any way he wants. And the anointing oil is a point of contact. You know, and then just as I said, I've had three people already contact me about, you know, half of the people I've sent oil to have already gotten their oil. Some of them Friday, some Saturday, and some today. And they were telling me that they applied it and they experienced, you know, that anointing in the oil. It is real, brothers and sisters. These things are real. You know, I can't be there. God knows I can't be there. It's His Holy Spirit. It's the anointing that God put on me. Now, lots of people who are watching this video, you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, so you probably, you know, you don't know what I'm talking about. It's just like talking to, you know, a blind person about the color blue versus the color red. You just don't, you have no point of reference on him if you have no experience with the Holy Spirit. But all of you who are really saved, even though you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, if you're truly born again and you had a truly encounter with the Lord through the Holy Spirit, you know, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, ever making intercession for us. He is there. So when you encountered the Lord, people say they encountered the Lord. It's really the Holy Spirit that you encountered, the Spirit of the living God. You know, there's the Trinity. They're all one, but yet different and all that. And I'm not making a video about that. And I'm not getting into doctrines. And I really don't care. Jesus is God. The Holy Spirit is God. God the Father is God. They're three in one. You know, God is, by definition, is beyond our understanding. And I don't really care to even to try to get into it. And, you know, I don't even know why in the church history they spent all these years debating this doctrine other than saying that Jesus is God and they're all three God. All of this dicing and mincing and trying to understand God just shows you the vanity and the arrogance of man. As I said, by definition, God is beyond understanding. If God says blue is green, then blue is green. It becomes green. That's it is. If God says it, it is. It doesn't matter. Who cares? Ultimately, God is beyond my understanding. And the more I learn about God, the more I find out I don't know about God. You know, the less I realize, the more I realize, the less, the little I know is what I'm saying. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm talking about the oil here. So you can anoint the people with oil and you pray for them. And the prayer of faith, of course, it's our prayer of faith. But brothers and sisters, I talked about that, and then one person made a comment saying, yes, a prayer of faith. That's true. But if the prayer of faith alone was working for people, then people use the oil, not just the anointing oil that the Lord led me to send out. But suppose they, you know, they say, as an example, let's talk about this. Now, I know lots of people do not like Benny Hinn, okay? And I'm not here to discuss the merits, to endorse or discredit or talk bad about, or talk good about, no comments about Benny Hinn. Okay, that's focus right here. Let's stay on subject. Stop majoring in the minors. And if you mention the names on here, I'm worried about your salvation, and I'm worried about your self-righteous, judgmental, hypocrite, pharisaical self. For those who would start that conversation, I'm not having it with any more people. I do not care. God is the judge. I'm not here to talk about those people. Okay, you want to talk about false prophets? You want to talk about Jehovah's Witnesses? You want to talk about the Mormons? You want to talk about Islam? You want to talk about some Buddhism and all that? You know, that's not anywhere by any question part of the kingdom of God? Yeah, let's talk about those false prophets. Truly nowhere near the gospel. Okay, anyway, I'm not going to talk about anybody that's in these areas, gray areas. Anyway, brothers and sisters, there are millions of people who have gone to Benny Hinn crusades, whether you or I like him or don't like him, or don't like his flamboyant suits or his private jet, they've been healed by God. And what is the reason for that, brothers and sisters? The most important thing to know is they went with the expectation of faith. Now I'm getting into a teaching on healing. Just like the one with the issue of blood. She said, in the gospel, she said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. And there are people right now that says, if I go to the Benny Hinn crusade, I'll be made whole. I know that Benny Hinn, I believe that Benny Hinn is a man of God. I believe he has a gift of healing. If I go there, God's going to heal me if I go there to that crusade. And then I'm there in the presence of the praise and worship going on. 10,000 people in a coliseum in the as anywhere, but the United States. And if you go to Asia and Africa and all that, there's a million people there. The United States is 10,000 or 20,000 people. Anyway, you go there, and by faith, people are healed because that's their point of contact. And if they had not have went, they would not be healed because that's their point of contact. Just like the anointing oil, people believe by faith that's a point of contact. Brother Patrick and 100 people from YouTube prayed for this oil who are prayer warriors, and I believe that when I apply this oil, I'll be healed. Because I know this is the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. I know that it says in James, anointing, you know, any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church, elders of the church, anointing them with oil, and the prayer of faith shall heal the sick. I'm anointing myself as if the elders of the church are here laying hands on me through this oil as my point of contact, and I'll be healed. And they are. That's because it's the faith, and it is the oil too, because that's our point of contact, brothers and sisters. Just like the handkerchiefs that Paul prayed over, just like the shadow of Peter, just like all those thousands and thousands of people who were literally physically healed at Benny Hinn Crusades, because that was their point of contact. Brothers and sisters, God honors our faith and he honors his people through the acts that we would do by faith. Just as the woman of issue of blood. She said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. She touched him. She acted on what she said. Just like someone who applied the anointing oil. They said, I believe if I anoint myself with oil, I'll be healed. They applied the oil and they're healed. They acted on that. They prayed. They anointed themselves. Plus they prayed in the name of Jesus. Plus they said the Bible verses they know, like, by his stripes I am healed. Jesus, the word says in Matthew 8:17 that you healed all of our sicknesses and all of our infirmities. I receive that in Jesus' name. You anoint yourself with oil. You're healed. As an example, by your faith through that point of contact and also our prayers, myself and those others who prayed over that oil. It is counting in that oil. It's counting in God's count, brothers and sisters. Now, as I said, the woman with issue of blood, she said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. Now, what if she didn't touch the hem of his garment? She wouldn't have been made whole. If you didn't apply the oil, if you didn't pray, if you didn't go to the Benny Hinn Crusade, whatever is people's point of contact. Have someone, or go to the local Pentecostal church and have the elders of the church lay hands on you. Whatever's your point of faith, your point of contact, your point of faith. That's what people believe. It's where your faith is, brothers and sisters. That's where God is meeting us there. So this woman touched his hem of his garment. And then Jesus said, you know, said, who touched me? And Peter said, there's a whole throng of people touching you. What do you mean, who touched me? And Jesus said, someone touched me by faith. Virtue went out of me. Someone touched me by faith. See, people were touching Jesus, but not by faith. They weren't healed. They didn't have an experience with God because they weren't doing it by faith. So just the anointing oil, the shadow of Peter, and the prayer cloths, you know, the handkerchiefs that Paul touched, they would have been of no effect if the people didn't have faith added to the anointing of that preacher. It's like my anointing and the anointing of the other people that prayed over the oil. It's included with your faith, the person that would use the oil and the people you would apply it to. Your faith is going on them. I want to say this. This is just an addition as I'm thinking about it. Of course, a non-believer. God heals non-believers by his mercy. God uses mercy to heal non-believers. He uses the covenant of grace through his blood to heal believers. Brothers and sisters, we are healed through the covenant that we have with God, through the blood of Christ, that by his stripes we were healed. But God heals the non-believer by mercy, overriding all of those things. He reaches out, boom, to seek and save the lost. He will override all things, no matter what's going on. They might even have no faith. They might be the hardest core atheist that ever lived. They could be like the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus, full of hate and evil and going in murderous wrath to kill Christians. Saul of Tarsus, who is also Paul, the Apostle Paul. FYI, for those of you who have not read your Bible, which you should, in the book of Acts chapter 9, we see that Saul of Tarsus, a.k.a. later on to be known as the Apostle Paul, was on a road to Damascus from Jerusalem with orders from the high priest to kill Christians and persecute them in Damascus and bring them into bondage and prison and have them killed for blasphemy, for proclaiming Jesus was the Christ. And on the road, the Lord in his mercy appeared to Paul. Nothing that Paul had done, but the Lord had predestined him. That's another thing people try to tell you, all of this stuff. Their free will is there, and it's a mystery, brothers and sisters. Free will is real, but it's also a mystery. Paul's will and desire was overridden by God's plan and God's election and God's calling in his life that overrode that plan that Paul had and made the Saul of Tarsus, the Apostle Paul that we know him as from the rest of the Bible, past Acts chapter 9. And brothers and sisters, we're all like that, myself included. I was once blind, but now I see. It's like the Lord struck Saul of Tarsus blind when he appeared to him on the road. And then 3 days later, there's a brother that came, and Ananias, who came and laid hands on him, and the scales fall off his eyes, and he could see in the natural. And that was symbolic of him being able to see, you know, coming out of darkness into the light of salvation. Then Ananias laid hands on him, and he was baptized in the Holy Spirit, brothers and sisters. That's what I'm really talking about in my teaching. Anyway, brothers and sisters, all of us have been there. All of us were blind, but now we see. We were all lost, but we're now found. God uses all these things, brothers and sisters, to bring us into his kingdom. So I want to remind those of you who are among my viewers, who are elders in the church, you're mature in the faith, don't hide behind the computer. You could be sick. You could have all kinds of infirmities, unable to do anything. But if you're able to turn on a video, you're able to read emails. We have maybe one a day, email alert of someone who has an urgent prayer request, people that find out they're dying of cancer, people who's, you know, that their parents were in car wrecks or whatever it is, and they're in critical condition, all this kind of stuff. You could pray even just 1 minute for those people and do something. Do something for the kingdom of God besides being a Dead Sea Christian, just absorbing, looking for blessing, but there's nothing flowing out. God told Abraham, I bless you that you can be a blessing. You know, I don't want to get into all that teaching about it, but people talking about, you know, all of this pious, pompous, false, you know, religious, pompous attitude. And, you know, I just want to be, I'm not worried about God blessing me. I just want to be poor and all this. God calls us to spiritually and literally, physically help the poor, widows and orphans and all those things. It takes wisdom. It takes patience. It takes all the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5. It takes finances. It takes, you know, you have to have a computer, you know, to go online and do it. You have to be able to know how to do all those things online. God will give us, equip us in all things we need to do to serve him, brothers and sisters. God will equip us with all the things that we need to serve him. But you have to commit your free will to serve him. That's why I'm giving a call out today for you to serve the Lord. And yes, and give the praise reports about the anointing oil. Ask those people praise reports about the anointing oil to put comments at the bottom. Just like before when I was doing all these videos, giving people a word. You know, on every video, I had, you know, I would give like a word to like 20 people, and I would have, you know, 10 people talk, you know, giving a praise report of the words that the Lord gave me to give. You know, and brothers and sisters, we can all operate, even though we have different callings and different giftings and different, like yours might be the gift of healing, or it might be the gift of interpretation or of tongues or whatever, or prophecy or whatever the Lord would give you. You know, words of wisdom, those words I were giving people were words of wisdom and words of knowledge. Sometimes prophecy, you have to study all those things out and see what's the difference. That's another video, and I made videos about that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the only difference between me and many of you is I said, Lord, here I am, use me, here am I, send me. Like Isaiah chapter 6, that's the only difference. I said, okay, Lord, here I am, use me. You know, and even though myself, I'm not 100% surrendered every second of my life to the Lord, you know, I still, you know, want to take a chill pill sometimes and just do nothing, you know, take an hour off, and you know, my wife will want me to watch a TV show with her, and I do that. It's about spending time, you know, with my wife versus, you know, what we're watching on TV. I don't really care. You know, I'm not sitting around keeping up with the Kardashians and all those things. I could care less, brothers and sisters. You know what I'm saying? But brothers and sisters, you have got to surrender your life to God. You have to surrender your life to God. And to all those religious people, you know, I just say to you, if you don't know the Holy Spirit, I don't, there, for me, you cannot know Jesus if you don't know the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the one. Jesus said he won't speak of himself, but he'll speak about me. He'll bring glory to me, the Lord tells us in the Gospel of John at the Last Supper. The Holy Spirit will be, I believe it's John chapter 16, the Holy Spirit will talk about me, Jesus. So you can't know about Jesus. You can't experience any encounter with Jesus unless you've had that encounter with the Holy Spirit of God. You can't have one without the other. They're all three one. You can't have the Father without the Son, as the Bible says. You can't have the Son without the Father. You can't have either one of them without a personal encounter and experience with the Holy Spirit. And those religious people, those old Pharisees, always love to say, oh, it's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I don't think they understand the definition of personal relationship. It's not a personal relationship. It's all right here. I've used this example before. Let me use this example again. I know I'm supposed to be talking about the anointing oil. I got a copy of my book right here. I know the Lord's going to make a way. One day, Sid Roth is going to invite me to come on there. Probably my book is not usually the kind of stuff he has. He usually has people talking about their experiences. You know, and that's what I'm going to do. There's a sister I was talking to tonight who's asking me all questions about my personal testimony, and I need to tell it, but anyway, it's just like not my book. It's not a biography of anybody, but I just picked it up, brothers and sisters, just to show it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I thank the Lord that He gave me this book to write. I don't care. I'm proud of the fact that the Lord let me write a book, you know, and it's really a great message from the Lord. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I think I've sold 1,000 copies, so praise the Lord for that. It's a blessing and a miracle, you know, to even write a book, much less sell 1,000 copies. It's already a lot to me. It's probably not a lot to, you know, Bill O'Reilly or someone that sells millions of copies, but it's a huge blessing, and it's awesome that the Lord allowed me to do that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, it's just like if you had a biography of President Obama, and you read the biography of President Obama. You read every Wikipedia and every encyclopedia and everything you could find, all of his relatives and friends, and you talked to all of them, interviewed them, and got all the information about President Obama you could. And then someone says, oh, do you know President Obama? Yeah, I know President Obama. I know all about him. He's 6'2". They say he was born in Kenya, but he could have been born in Hawaii. He was born this day, blah, blah, blah. You can give all the biographical data all about it. He's left-handed. His IQ is blah, blah, blah. I think about 20, but I think they said it's about 120, which is not that high really for a president. But anyway, go through all of it, you know, all about it. And then Obama walks into the room, and then we say, oh, there's Obama. Go over there and introduce us to him. You say, oh, well, I don't really know him. I know about him. I've been studying. I have a doctorate degree in Obama, but I don't actually know the man. I've never met him. See what I mean? So that's really what a high theologian is. It's someone that's got a PhD about God, but most of them have less than a kindergarten level personal knowledge of God and relationship with God. It's all right here. None of it's here. It's none of it's right here between them and God. It's just all head knowledge, brothers and sisters. And lots of people... That's not really the topic I'm talking about. But lots of people have this standoff relationship. That's for people. I'm talking about people who are critical of the Holy Spirit and people being healed and all that kind of stuff. You don't know. Besides, number one, all of these things are very clearly spoken about in the Bible. And I do videos all the time talking about what the Bible says. It can be backed up with 1,000 Bible verses. But put all of that aside and a personal encounter with the Lord. A personal encounter with the Lord. There is no price on that. It's like Isaiah chapter 6, in the year King Uzziah died, he was in the temple and he saw the Lord high and lifted up. And the train of his veil, of his robe filled the temple with glory. And the whole earth is filled with his glory. And that's when God said, you know, the Trinity there in the Old Testament, that's one example where we see the Trinity in the Old Testament. They said, who will go for us? And Isaiah said, here am I, send me. That's the text I've been referring to in this video. So brothers and sisters, you know, I answered the call. And every day, as Jesus said, Apostle Paul said, I die daily. You know, Jesus said that he, and in Luke, Jesus says it in different gospels. But in Luke, he said, he who does not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me daily. So brothers and sisters, every day when I get up, I have to make the commitment that, okay, I will follow the Lord today. I will try my best to serve the Lord today the best as I can. And where I fail, I will ask Him to forgive me. And His grace is sufficient for me in those areas when I fail Him today. Because I know I'm going to. It's no doubt. No one, only Jesse Duplantis lives a perfect life. Everybody else I know, we sin. We all fall short of the Lord's glory. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. I know I said I was going to make a short video, but I did all this message as the Lord led me, as you know I always do. I love all you guys. I pray for those of you who have not had a count with the Holy Spirit. And I know I probably weeded most of you guys out. If you've been watching my videos more than a few, you probably stopped watching me because you're not spiritual minded, but cardinal minded babes in Christ. But I pray for you. I pray that you'll humble yourself, Humble yourself. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. I'm not talking about salvation now. I'm talking about being baptized in the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit, that rivers of living water would flow out of your belly, that you would be used by God and do all, be all that you can be in the Lord. Stop being a babe and become like a David. Become a king in the kingdom of God. What did Jesus say? You know, the Lord told me this one time when I was praying with my prayer partner. I told you guys I helped start a church. I was the only white guy. Everybody in there was black. I guess the Lord was also preparing me for, you know, being a minority in the Philippines, you know, like the only one, the only American that I saw for months at a time in remote areas of the Philippines, only Filipinos. And so in this church, me and my prayer partner, we were prayer partners for 3 or 4 years. This pastor, Billy, is his name, first name. We used to pray. And then one time the Lord spoke to me when I was praying with him. And the Lord said, why do you think I say, you know, I'm the King of Kings. I'm the King of Kings. The King of Kings. So, you know, the Bible says that we are a kingdom of priests. You know, we are kings and priests unto the Lord. So we are kings in Christ, brothers and sisters. If you're a born-again Christian, we are kings with Christ. So we're supposed to rule and reign. Now, there's so many people that, praise God, but most of you are not. There are some people who are very critical of all these doctrines. And I'm talking about a kingdom theology doctrine that you see on television, if you know what I'm talking about. There's excesses in all of those things, brothers and sisters, but there are truth, core doctrines in all of those things. We are to rule and reign. We are to occupy till the Lord comes. We are not to be defeated in this world. We're supposed to have victory. Just like Israel was called to walk in victory in the natural, but yet because of all their sin and all their idolatry and all their disobedience to God, you know, God didn't give them the blessings of the law, but the curse of the law. Brothers and sisters, the Bible in the New Testament tells us that we are redeemed from the curse of the law. We're not under the curse of the law, but the blessings of the law, to be the head and not the tail. You know, to be blessed in the city and blessed in the country, blessed coming in and blessed going out, blessed in the field and blessed in the city. That's the church. We're called to that. We've been redeemed from the curse of the law. We're not under the curse of the law. Praise God, as Hebrews tells us, we have a better covenant than Israel's God. Amen. We don't have to practice all those rituals and sacrifice animals and all that. God sacrificed himself for us. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world came to earth as a man and died for us. As Jesus said, he has the right to judge us. Why? Because he is the Son of Man. He came, he knows what it's like to wake up when you're hot, cold, and all those things. Jesus experienced all those things as the Son of Man. That's why God has him judging us, because he is the Son of Man. Not only because he's God, but because he lived as a man. He was tempted in every way, but yet without sin. And I've mentioned this before. God the Father didn't do that. God the Father didn't come live as a man. That's why he came. God came and died on the cross, you know, experienced life as a man, as a carpenter's apprentice, as a young man, before he started his ministry, hard labor, all the things that the Lord did on this earth. Why? So he could, as it says that he's able to, you know, feel our infirmities. He feels our pain. As old Bill Clinton said, Jesus, the Bible tells us he is touched by our infirmities. He knows what it's like, you know, if you hit your hand with a hammer and all that. He knows that when he lived as a man, as a carpenter. So the Lord knows all that. We cannot fool him or trick him or, you know, make more out of it than what it is. But he is sympathetic to our situation. He's sympathetic to our pains, our sufferings, all those things. And the Lord is in the battle with us. He's in the trenches with us. He is in this life with us. And he said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He'll be with us always, even to the end of this age. Amen. He's with the church. Always in the midst of his church. And he's in us. The Holy Spirit is within us, brothers and sisters. So, the anointing oil, as I just covered a little bit. When you get your anointing oil, anoint yourself, and the prayer praises reports will be below. If you have a praise report about the oil, please put it on here, or any video that I make, put it on there to encourage others. Praise God. The demand for the oil, I keep having to buy and get new supplies. Praise God, I've got to order some plastic bottles. There's a sister that's supposed to send me about 10 plastic bottles, I think. But I think they might be kind of big. And number two, I don't have a mailbox the house I'm at. If you send United States Postal Service to this address I'm at, I won't be able to get it, I don't think. It needs to be sent by FedEx or UPS. But I have a Brother Sid's address. Brother Sid is only about 10 or 15 minutes away from me. So if someone wants to send me something, get in touch with me. I'll put you, we'll connect with Brother Sid. You can mail it to Brother Sid, like padded. I'm just mentioning it. You know, I keep buying them at Walmart. I could probably get them on cheap online. And when I have time, I will. Someone wants to send me the little, like a 4x8 padded envelopes. If you have some laying around, you want to get rid of them, I'll take them. Little plastic bottles, like 50 cc's, 50 milliliters or 50 cc's or less, 30 cc's, 1 ounce or 1.5 ounce maximum is going to be big enough, brothers and sisters. Because let me say this, I'm already 35 minutes in the video. You know me. But anyway, when you anoint the oil, you don't use the whole bottle. You only have to use one drop, brothers and sisters. Just take one drop. I've had a bottle of anointing oil I've been using for years. I've used like 2 bottles of anointing oil in 14 years. I mean, you know, and I'm a tight wad with everything, brothers and sisters. A very tight wad with everything. I always use a minimal amount, but I mean, it's just a little bit. It's a point of contact. Use a, you know, take, then put your finger over the lid and get one drop on there. You know, you don't want to make people's all greased up anyway. You know what I mean? You know, it doesn't necessarily mean like more oil is more anointing, okay? It's just a little oil is a point of contact. You know, God knows even a molecule, you know, one atom of the oil or whatever, one molecule of the oil, the Lord knows it. It's the same as, you know, pouring a whole bottle over somebody's head. You don't need to do that. So that's why the bottle only needs to be 1 or 2 ounces, because it will last you for years. Just need a drop or two. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. The link, if you want some oil down there, you know, take donations. It's cost a whole lot more to send overseas. Got bottles to send to India. That's why I'm waiting on the plastic bottles before I send the oil to India. I have been waiting on plastic bottles, too, for even England. But I think I'm feeling kind of spunky. I'm feeling kind of upbeat about it. I think I will try to send the glass bottles to England just for grins and see if it makes it through. Just for fun. Scotland and England. And then maybe even Australia. Now, the Indian to India, I better go definitely with the plastic, you know, because you don't know what kind of route it's got to go through. It's like the Philippines. You know, and I'm sure it's about the same. You know, who knows what it, how it's going to be handled and how many years it might take to get there. And it'd be a miracle if it arrives. I know how the Philippines is. I'm sure India is the same way. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. You know, I always keep going and going and going. anyway, I ask you guys to pray, because the reason why, right before I got on this video, dear sweet sister Holly Bogus, who I wanted to go up there and meet in West Virginia, her and her husband are such nice, they, from what I know them from the internet, they're such nice people. Anyway, on Facebook, Sid Roth was asking, who should I invite on my show? Who should I interview? And dear Sister Holly recommended me. So praise God for that. So, you know, who knows if Sid would see that. But I'd love to send him a copy of my book. I need to do that. You know, and so any of these Christian TV shows, I would love to get on there, brothers and sisters, to advance the message of the book. And then the message of revival, brothers and sisters, is number one. Then, of course, if the Lord wants me to build 100 orphanages, you know, it's going to take, you know, what is that going to be? Whatever. Say $50,000 per orphanage. You figure it out. How much is that? $500,000 to build 100 orphanages, much less maintain them. You know, that's $50,000 is to get it built and get started. You know, then you need a couple thousand dollars a month per orphanage to run them. So, brothers and sisters, you know, it's going to take a huge amount of funds to do that. And God can provide that. And through something like the Sid Raw Show or something, that will be one fruit of that. We can build lots more orphanages, if that's what the Lord wants. And I believe the Lord wants me to keep building as many orphanages as we can, even not just the Philippines, but all over the world. You know, it's part of the calling that God gave me. But it's not my heart's desire. My heart's desire is to bring the anointing to God's people, to get words for people, to see people repent, to see people get healed, to see people get saved, baptized in the Holy Spirit, to operate in revival, you know, to see God move on the church, on His people, and an assembly of His people. That's what I live for. That's why there's a sister that asked me about coming up to a church in Michigan. I don't care if, as long as I can get there, I don't care how much snow on the ground, how cold it is, if a church will invite me to preach, you know, a gathering of God's people, I'll go. That's my, you know, as Paul said, woe is me if I don't preach the gospel. That's me, brothers and sisters. Any group of people that will, you know, the pastor will let me speak, I'll go. I went to the church last time and I spoke between the Sunday, you know, between the two services to the adult Sunday school, which is awesome. But during the church service, they let me speak 5 minutes. And the whole 5 minutes, they kept looking at their watch. And it's a very religious church. It was a Methodist church. I doubt that anyone in the church is born again, maybe just one or two, just by their own relationship with the Lord. As a matter of fact, I know some that are, personally know some that are born again Christians, but They got saved like at a Baptist evangelism crusade. They didn't get saved in the church. Of course not. They're not preaching the gospel. How could someone get saved unless they hear, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 10. How can they hear unless someone is sent? You know, so no one can get saved. Faith comes by hearing, hearing of the word of God. So if you don't hear the gospel, you can't respond to the gospel. That's why, you know, praise God, that's why we need to have gospel more advanced. That's why we need, you know, there are so many fake people. You know, I already talked in this video about Benny Hinn. You know, there's so many charlatans on TV. People want their ears tickled. That's when you get your Joel Osteens and all this kind of stuff. I mean, that's the problem. There's very few legitimate, straight up, you know, from the heart preachers on TV. Very few. You know, there are some. You know, I don't want to start naming names. I like Dr. Jack Benimpe a lot. He's a Baptist. But he preaches the gospel and evangelizes every week and has a prayer for people to get saved every week on his show and talking about the end times. And a very sincere man of God. You know, and you don't always have to talk about the gifts of the Spirit and all that. Number one thing is people to be saved. Being baptized in the Holy Spirit is empowering you to be a witness for the Lord, as he said in Acts chapter 1, to be a witness for him. Of course, it also empowers you to live a sanctified life. Okay? And that's the purpose of being baptized in the Holy Spirit. Those are some of the purposes of being baptized in the Holy Spirit. You can be used by God in power, in wisdom and in power. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Excuse me, starting at verse 1, the Apostle Paul said, I didn't come to you with the wisdom of man and excellent speech, but I came to you with power of the Holy Ghost, that your faith might not be in the wisdom of man, but in the power of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 through 5, you can read that text. It's a great text, and I love to read in Baptist churches. And I even asked some of the Baptist deacons and elders that I know, what do you think that text means? They said, oh, it's just a transformation in people's lives when they get saved. That's the power that Paul's talking about. No, I think he was talking about, he said, in demonstrations of power. I think he was talking about people being physically healed in front of people, people speaking in tongues, people giving words of wisdom, words of knowledge, prophecy, and all that kind of stuff, the power gifts and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I believe that's what he was referring to. Not just, you know, someone's changed life. Oh, he stopped drinking. No. Those are fruit of our relationship with the Lord. But the power of God manifested and demonstrated on the spot is the gifts of the Spirit. Healings and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as you know, I've gone on for a long time, as usual. But I know that some of you guys love it. Praise God for all you guys. We're like-minded, I guess. You know, birds of a feather flock together, as they say. We're like-minded in the Lord. So praise God for that. And I thank God that, you know, there's so many great people. You know, when I get on the phone, I always intend on talking to people a short time. But I always end up talking to people for a long time, you know, that are, you know, like-minded and talking. We start talking about the Lord and all that and go on and on and on. You know, and that's, it's just the joy of it. So, you know, all you guys that I've talked to, you know that I love you, and I know there's a lot more of you. There's only one of me, though, but there's lots more of you I'm sure I would love to talk to every day if I could. By the grace of God, and when we get there to heaven in the rapture, we'll be together, and we can talk in eternity. You know, hey, there's no time. You can talk all you want. After we spend time with the Lord, right, we probably won't be interested in talking to each other about the Lord when we're there with the Lord. So, but after, you know, after a certain number of thousand, maybe 100, a couple hundred years, we'll have time to sit down and talk. I'm sure that there is a Starbucks coffee in heaven, right? Or the coffee in heaven's better than Starbucks. Starbucks is probably like dirty sewer water compared to the coffee in heaven, right? Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. You know that I love you. And I ask you to pray, continue to pray for the anointing oil. If you'd like the anointing oil, the information's below. And if I send it to you overseas, I don't know how long it's going to take. It's going to take longer. I do a customs form and all this stuff, but I'll do it because it's for the Lord. It's for you guys, and I want to get it out to you. It's going to take probably at least a couple of weeks, you know, maybe, especially India. It could take months. And the brother there, he knows that, just like I know it, like in the Philippines. It took me like 6 months. As a matter of fact, my mom, the first year I was in the Philippines, and I moved there in 2007, my mom sent me a Christmas card probably about December the 1st. I believe I got it in July or August. I got the Christmas card. So it took like 7 months to get there. I mean, and this is not even considered. If you say something to them, they just laugh at the post office. They would just laugh about it, you know. if you said something and they got and you made said enough to make them mad, they may, you know, come burn down your house. I mean, this is the third world for you, brothers. That's why they need the gospel so bad. Lawlessness doesn't begin to describe third world countries. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. I thank the Lord. I thank you for your prayers. Also, for the book, like I said, we sold about 1,000 copies of the book. Praise the Lord for that. You know, may it be 1,000,000 copies. May the message get out. May the Lord make a way. I ask you guys to pray about that. I can get on Sid Roth or Prophecy in the News or some of this. My book's along the line, probably more Prophecy in the News. But now Gary Stearman has got his own show with Dr. Tom Horn. So a totally different thing. He's not on Prophecy in the News anymore. So by the grace of God, so they can advance the kingdom of God, advance Joshua's ministry for to help more orphans. And, you know, we're feeding 800 kids a week, brothers and sisters. I'd like to feed 8,000. If God provided, we'd feed 8,000 kids a week or whatever. You know, we need more finances. I need more pastors in the Philippines to work with. We need more laborers to do the feedings and all that. You know, Jesus said the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send more laborers into the field. So I need more trustworthy laborers in the Philippines to be house moms and dads, to do the feedings, all that, churches, more churches to work with. I've tried to work. In the 7 years I was in the Philippines, I probably worked with 1,000 churches. And I can count on my two hands the pastors who I would trust with money, pastors I would trust, you know, to preach the gospel. And it's probably the same thing is true with the American churches. Maybe not that bad, but, you know, there's lots of churches that it's just not, you know, it's just not building the Lord's kingdom, but building their own kingdom or their own denomination or whatever. You know, you guys know that. That's why you're on YouTube and not in, you know, at your local assembly of whatever they are tonight. Anyway, God bless you guys. Again, I keep trying to sign off. Anyway, guys, I thank you for your prayers. And I ask you to please consider, if you're a mature Christian, to be a prayer warrior. Even if you're not a mature Christian, you know, if you're a new Christian, you can still let Brother Sid know. You can still be on the prayer team, you know. And then, you know, you could use it to develop. That's the whole thing, like I said. You know, I'm trying to develop leaders in the church. You know, I'm trying to develop my ability to help people be developed. You know, it's we're all at different levels. And God is using me to help those who are coming up higher and wanting to go higher in their walk with the Lord. And then those people are helping others and et cetera. That's the job of the church. That's what we do. We mentor each other in the areas where we have weaknesses. We all have weaknesses, myself included, you know. And God would assign someone to me to help mentor me in an area where I need help. That's how God works, you know. None of us are above the law. And I mean the law, and I mean in a figurative speech, you know, of above correction from the Lord. And sometimes he uses people when he doesn't speak to us directly or through his word. He will use his elders to speak to us. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. Love you. I will see you all soon up there in the air. If not, I'll see you in another video. God bless you all.